Welcome everybody to this fourth session of this course. Today we'd be talking about mainly about the policy around fecal sludge and septage management, the regulatory frameworks around septage management. Later on, we'll move into look into what is fecal sludge, what constitutes fecal sludge, and then what Avinash, would you put the slides down?
Yes.
We would be talking about the different regulations that are there, that what are the existing standards, different kinds of environmental standards. I'll just speak, give you a glance of the different kinds of environmental standards with respect to water, air, solids that are existing in the country. And then we would move into the fecal sludge, what its characters, what are the parameters, what are the standards are, and how we should look into it. So this would be a session. We begin with the session with the FSSM policy and the framework around it. And here, Professor Chari would be taking you through this part of the session. Professor Chari, for you.
Thank you, Dr. Banerjee. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good evening, friends. Good afternoon. Some of you are in different time zones. Welcome to the session. I'm very happy to, I always look forward to interacting with all of you every week, twice a week rather. So today we're going to speak about as a next logical steps. You know, in the last two sessions, rather three sessions, we discussed about citywide inclusive sanitation, what it is about, then what are the key elements of citywide inclusive sanitation. Last week we had a leading example, the Japanese Jokoaso Act, which has sort of outlined the policy and regulatory framework for on-site sanitation system and how on-site and off-site they combine strengths for improved public health, but more importantly for protecting water bodies and lakes. The reason why they do this is it's not only just to improve public health outcomes, but very importantly, to improve the cleanliness of water bodies, cleanliness of the surrounding environment, preventing disease burden. So now the journey is going to be, how do we do it? So far it's all about know-how. So we have this know-how. Okay, we have done this in Kampala. It's been done in Warangal or XYZ. It's done in Japan. But now it's time, from now onwards, we will start moving into so-called do how. How do we do it? What are the key elements? And anything, be it any public sanitation or public service or public health, it is, there are multiple ways we can improve the situation. One is through awareness. So one way of improving public service or any public agenda is through awareness programs. For example, you see signboards, do not smoke, it's a public health issue. So we put up signboards. So that awareness, sometimes it can have an impact, positive impact, but many a times it may not be sufficient. It is not a necessary condition. So then you move to what is called pricing. What is it, pricing? Then you try to impose taxes on smokers or cigarettes. So we start with awareness, then we move to pricing to discourage people to or to behave in a particular way. Okay, so the second instrument in public policy we often use is by putting a price, environmental price or through taxes, you know, that sort of things. The third instrument, which is equally important, and I think it's that is what, which I mean, many times work, is through regulations and policies. So fecal sludge and septage management, or even used water management, it's a public health issue. We discussed at length. And I encourage right now, I encourage many of you who are in a position to keep the video on. Please keep your video on. Otherwise, I'll be speaking to a what is called a dummy wall. So I'm not a person, I'm a teacher by heart, and I don't like to speak to a dummy wall. I would like to see cheerful faces and cheerful peers.
No, Dr. Jai, we all are there.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And especially you have, you know, you inspire because you have SDG all the time behind you. So it reminds me, you know, of my own, what can I say, my responsibility. So anyways, so the third instrument we use in any public policy issue is a policy and regulation. I'll explain a bit because it's important to have theoretical construct before I get into FSM policy and related issues. Be it smoking, be it, drunk driving, or wearing a helmet. These are all, you know, issues of public policy. We need to have awareness. We need to have pricing instruments. And then we also need to have what is called a strong regulatory signal. Now, since sanitation is a public health issue and it is a municipal service, which we spoke at length, we need these instruments, such as policies and regulations, to control, to manage or to behave our actions in a particular direction. So today, what I'm going to speak is some of the leading practices or some of the important aspects in citywide inclusive sanitation policies and regulations. Okay. So though it is titled as FSSM regulation, I'm going to speak a little more on from a CVIS lens, citywide inclusive sanitation lens. And I'm going to quote some leading practices. Okay. Now, what are the policies and regulations? You know, generally we use it so casually. Ek policy bana lenge, ek regulatory system bana lenge. Policies are basically unwritten laws that have to be followed in letter and spirit by the constituents. It could be employees or it could be citizens of an organization or of a geography. Suppose you are an organization. Aapka organization mein UNICEF mein jo hai, wahan pe aap bold letter pe likhte hai ki smoking is not encouraged. Wo ek policy hai. Likewise, FSM, we need to have periodic desludging once in 3 years. It's a good policy. Now, regulations are basically rules that are made to make people comply and behave in a certain way. And if you don't comply, then there could be incentives and disincentives. Policy is more of an intent, an unwritten intent, whereas regulations are rules. If you don't wear seat belt, then you will be penalized. You can put behind bars. Jo Cyrus Mistry ka saab ka jo hua hai, wo incident ke baad humne ek regulation la liya. So I'm speaking in bit of Hindi, but after the incident, people who are sitting at the back seat are actually not regulated to wear a seat belt like in US, like in Europe and other countries. We allowed it only after that incident. Now motor vehicle acts are going to be amended and then the rule regulations are going to be introduced. This is, the teacher in me is saying all this, so don't mind, because this is a theoretical construct, which I think we need to have an understanding. Often we confuse between policy kya hai, regulation, what is regulation? So we need to start probably with a policy, communicate that policy, but eventually you need to move towards a strong regulation, without which citizens and municipalities and constituents, partners, they may not listen. Hand is up. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
So just some clarification.
Yes.
When we talk about the policy could be any organization, private government or public sector and regulation. So I'm saying from the perspective of government. So yes. Government also has the policy, and government and an organization do. So do you mean the policy has to be followed by the person who is within the government implementation on policy making framework and not as a whole public, unless that policy is converted into regulation?
Of course. So what happens, Mr. Singh, you said a very important point. You know, the policy, for example, FSM policy, just basic sense of subject of conversation. Now the municipality has to do something. Citizens have to do something. Citizens have a responsibility to. Now that policy will say, these are the roles and responsibilities of different stakeholders. But the stakeholder may not behave in the way you want them to behave. The municipality may not behave the way you want them to behave, though the government, state governments or national governments bring out the policies. So to make them to behave in a particular way, be it a periodic desludging or be it a segregation of waste or not urinating in public, or it could be anything related to, you know, wearing a PPE. It has to be backed up by a regulatory instrument.
So can we say that a regulatory is some sort of mechanism which try to enforce the policy, whether you are really following those things or not?
Correct. Wo rules hai bas. Policy, aapne jo intent kiya hai policy mein, it has to be you are giving the set of rules, directions to make it mandatory, to make, to incentivize or disincentivize. Incentivize kyo? Suppose if you put a rainwater harvesting, I will give you a rebate on property tax. That's called incentivization. If you don't wear a helmet, you will be behind bars. That is a disincentivization instrument. These are different instruments in public policy. Okay, I'm taking it on a theoretical construct, but you know, I don't want to stay here for too long. We will move into FSM, but if there are any burning questions, I would be happy to take. Okay, now I'm going to use the state of Telangana as a backdrop, because my colleague Josna also told that we had some conversations around FSM policy in the earlier conversation. So let us not focus, let's use a case study approach. So I'm going to use a case study approach where what constitutes a good FSSM regulatory construct. And I would like you to, all of you, you're coming from different geographies, whether it is Nepal, Bangladesh, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, all of you at some point in time, those who have not done, please do it. But many of you have your own policies and certain regulations in place. So what we are doing is we are going to discuss and debate ki kya chalta hai, kya nahi chalta hai, where we have to convert. So I'm going to speak about some of the leading practices. If you have not done it, please take this conversation and presentation for converting or coming up with a good FSSM policy. So last week we heard Hashimoto-san speaking about a couple of very fundamental issues in Japan. So the first and the foremost thing your policy should say is that sanitation should be a public service. That is a preamble of your policy. Please make sure, if it is not there, get it done. If it is not there, please get it done. What is the first statement your policy should say, Mr. Singh? Sanitation, on-site sanitation, off-site sanitation, whichever may be, is a public service. That is a statement we have to communicate. It is not just ki design karna hai. It is not about FSTP alone. Your city-wide sanitation policy, if it is not there, please do it. We are also going through a lot of amendments now. That sanitation, on-site, off-site, kaha pe hai, the human waste management, both solids and liquids have to be a public service and a municipal function. That's a preamble of your policy. Number one. Number two, what are the key constituents of a good construct, regulatory constructs? We typically use 3x3 matrix, 9. we can add more. In fact, we have added more, but just to communicate easily, 9 fundamental building blocks of a good citywide inclusive sanitation. The first principle is, please say openly, blatantly in your policy statements that it is a public service, that it is a municipal function. Number 2, the second component is, Manjusha, whoever is there on the call, time check please. Otherwise, the teacher in me will consume 1.5 hours. So yes, please,
you can,
teach
no,
your
you can
have to you alert can, me.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I will.
So it's very important to follow timelines. Otherwise, you know, it's not good.
Yeah.
Your session is much more important than my session. So the
You started a bit late. So let's take it.
So the second important thing, please, all of us should remember, on-site sanitation system is a treatment unit. It is not a dumping unit. It is not a holding tank. Be it a Jocasso, be it a septic tank, or be it even a twin pit toilet. Single pit is not acceptable. It is not a treatment system. It will promote manual scavenging. So if you want to have on-site sanitation, whichever may be the solution you opt, based on the land availability, budget availability, local capacity, incentives, disincentives, subsidies, they have to follow what is called design and construction practices. So aapka section 1 is about designing and construction of septic tanks or on-site systems. Section 2, how do you transfer or translate your legacy system into a safe sanitation system? That's a part 2 of your regulatory construct. Legacy to hai hamara purana. Just to draw a parallel, if you are in an earthquake zone, the new construction can be properly earthquake proof buildings. But to prevent death and destruction, old buildings have to be refurbished. Would you agree? So we have to also deal with the old legacy sanitation systems which are not following the design principles. So we need to, your regulatory construct should speak about it. And it should give directions. It should have penalties. It should give time frame. Like single-use plastic shall be phased out in the next 1 year. That was a timeline, transition timeline. So again, I'm giving you leading practices. When I say leading, it means good practices. So keep including these elements. If you don't have it, go for amendment and get it done. And you can also discuss with us in this call, what are the other leading practices which should be there. Third, ye to ho gaya, on-site system. Now, the whole pumping and desludging, that's where the human touch will come. That's where the mechanization should come. That's where safety could be compromised. What should be the safe pumping and desludging practices is a third element of the third section of your policies or regulatory framework. The fourth section of your good regulatory construct is safe transportation. Jo aap petrol, diesel, or any hazardous material, you see any truck, can they take it in any truck? Mr. Singh, it has to be an empaneled truck. Even petrol yes. transportation is empaneled. And uske piche likha rahta hai, 3YE, that is what hazardous safety practices we should follow in case of a spill, in case of a turtle top, you know, when it gets stripped, or if there is a fire, because transportation could potentially cause hazardous situations. How do we deal with it? This is the fourth component. The next component of your good regulatory construct would be safe transportation, treatment, processing, disposal, and reuse. Because we are going through a service chain. These are all known to you, but I'm just giving why we are doing it and what is the intent of all this. Next, of course, is we need a certain behaviors by citizens. So we need to have information, education, communication, and sometimes it has to be mandatory. Periodicity of desludging, safety. When a worker comes to my house for desludging, I should, as a citizen, I have a responsibility to ensure that that person wears PPE. Otherwise, I will not allow. We are working on it. We're changing, bringing new regulations. It is not the responsibility of the officer concerned, municipality concerned, because many times the household is directly dealing with the desludger in private sector. But citizen has a role to play in this. That's where you ask Mr. Singh, is it the, you know, rules are meant to be only for government or even for citizens? Citizen ko bhi bahut hi isme hai, because it's a public service. Unke paas, if there is insanitary toilet in a household and he is bloody leaving all the shit downstairs, it is impacting the neighbor. So it's a responsibility of citizen. Next is, of course, is the capacity building components. All stakeholders concerned. Very important, like COVID. We have 6 months, you know, vaccination, periodicity, reporting. We have this app where we report periodically. Earlier, we used to have an app where if I am traveling abroad, I come back, or traveling in within different cities, I have to notify. That's called record keeping in MIS. When was it desludged? What happened? Where is this truck going? GPS systems. Then, of course, this whole system requires certain amount of information, and it also requires certain technical assistance. Many a times is not aware of, many stakeholders are not aware of. So helpline for septage management is another component which we have added. Many a times it is not added, but we have added. Now we can add more. A department, creating a department to strengthen this or to make it work is also part of a regulatory construct. The staffing norms in that department could also be part of the regulatory construct. So let me take it forward one by one. For example, the first step is design and construction. I mentioned to you, we made it a point to make it mandatory. It is not an intent. Policy is an intent. It's a regulation that all building constructions henceforth should follow 2470. There is an input. How many people are there in the household? That would become your input variable. Based on that, length, breadth, depth will be defined. And then that building approval system will check whether they are following, whether they are providing a toilet, well-designed toilet or not. Otherwise, the building approval system rejects. You may have beautiful building with setbacks, with height restrictions, FAR, all that will be there. But if the toilet is not following as per the standards, the building approval could be stalled. So we did one exercise. Our team went to all the recently approved buildings in Warangal, and then they validated, and then 94% of the buildings are complying with the standards. There are 6% deviations. So humko regulate karna hai. Oh, even if you see, you go out on main road, 90%, 95% are wearing a helmet. 3-4 bachas are moving here and there, triple ride, they move around, escape, gullies. So that is there, even in this, it is there. But there is a sense of regulation, there is a sense of fear. Now I learned another new term. I spoke about 4 F's, right? What are those 4 F's? Earlier in my session, opening inaugural session, framework,
functions
have to be devolved. Then next one, ma'am.
Functionaries.
Beautiful. Finance. Then
finances.
Now I'm adding another F, not my original. Another F is fear. People should be fearful of certain rules and regulations.
Professor Tari, here I was also thinking in context of the different design that we are talking about. Let's say for the flood prone area or somewhere. So do we have a really IS some sort of specification for, of course, for septic tank we have, but there are other options also.
Like high water table situations.
Yes.
So, nahin, sir, wo high water table situations ka liye guidelines kafi hai. We have situations for emergency situations, high water table situations, but they're not coded in IS 2470.
Yes.
2740.
So in that case, I was just trying to reflect myself that sometimes why we pull, even if we have the best of intention to really comply the policy and regulation. So sometimes, even as you mentioned, the 4F, one is the finance and the capacity. So even if I have the best of my intention to construct my own septic tank, but I cannot find a very trained mason or the plumber who can really do that one.
This That's a beautiful question. That's a beautiful question. Just wait for the next slide. The next slide, which is exactly what you're saying. Ye toh bohut hi bada intention hai. It's all wishful thinking. You need to have human capacity and skilling to convert that idea into tangible product. You absolutely preempted it. Now, in water table situation, we need to amend it. High water table. So the second thing is we need to have skilled people to execute this on-site systems, which are regulated, but also they should be empaneled. They should be empaneled. So please make sure we have a very young student, very bright student. Thank you very much, Mr. Reddy. So we have to train and empanel these those who are going to construct. Mestri bolte hain kai jagah pe, hum jo mason bolte hain, all these people have to be, because eventually they are the designers. We don't have B-techs and M-techs for designing this. We don't have structural engineers for designing this. So we need these masons and trainers. Do's and don'ts. Loads of information is available, Mr. Reddy and others. Please feel free to reach out to us. We have design guidelines, we have manuals, we have in local language, do's and don'ts. These are all important. And these design guidelines and manuals should also be communicated to citizens. Municipality ke taraf se aap ek bhej diye, aap along with the building approval. When you give a building approval, you give a NOC. Along with that, you please attach this do's and don'ts. It doesn't cost much. And from your municipality, you can disseminate this. In fact, I told you in my earlier presentation, even in developed countries, Australia and others, they have a helpline. And that's how I borrowed that idea. In fact, you'd be surprised. I went to Australia on non-sewer sanitation issues 25 years back or 20 years back. That's where this idea of a helpline came. And we have embedded it 2017 or 18 with a title in Warangal called, you know, that bird, Palapitta, and then there's a helpline as a mascot. Okay, this is the second thing. Third thing, conversion of insanitary toilets to sanitary toilets, very, very important. We are struggling, very open about it. It's not easy. But there are fiscal incentives made available under SBM2. And as a, so we use this, but very forcefully it has to be enforced. Why? 90% of your city is ODF, but this 10% insanitary toilet can create a mess. So create this mechanism, incentives and disincentives. Municipal system mein bolte hain red or red slip bhejo aap. Pink slip is sacking. Red slip is alert. It will penalize you. So this is the third. Conversion is very important. Design guidelines have been told how to convert. It's not easy. Sometimes these facilities are inside the house. The house has expanded. It could be in the kitchen. It could be in the bathroom. It could be. So there are certain operational challenges, very tricky. But if you are interested, there are some design thinking solutions. There are some agencies who have done it. We have done a couple of them. There is an agency in Pune. I'm not able to recall someone. Person called Pratima, she would be very happy to do it. Shelter Associates. So they do a good job in optimizing the design in such a way that even in a constrained situation, they can help design on-site conversion of insanitary to sanitary system. Very important aspect as a part of this whole agenda is, if there is a constraint of toilet availability in sanitary toilets, so people are using on-site systems. But when people are in mobile, when they have a lot of trading happening, you need to have what is called aspirational and inclusive public toilets. And they have to be monitored very systematically. Last time when we went to Warangal, you saw smell sensors, water sensors. I'm telling you, if you are going for it, embedded in the contract itself. We'll be happy to give you the contact details. Sensor costs have come down dramatically. All you need is smell sensor, water level sensor, footfall sensor. I'll give you, yesterday I was reviewing some work of one of our vendors who was into sensor. There's a sharp dip in a public convenience in Warangal. Sharp dip. Men toilet and women toilet, the footfall of women were more. All these weeks, suddenly there is a dip. Then we inquired why there is a dip. The dip was because, dip means footfall has come down. People are not using it because the door of that particular public toilet was broken. Women's section, it was broken. There was a hole and it was broken. So these ICT systems, monitoring systems can be very, very helpful. In Telangana, as I said, as CDM said, we have one toilet per 1,000 seats and a lot of toilets are built. She toilets are important, exclusive. We have a gender session later. But these are all mechanisms you need to build in your regulations. This was not a part of our regulation. One toilet seat per 1,000 population is was not. But now it is part of the norm. Yes, please. Go ahead.
I just saw the mobile toilet. So I just wonder, you know, in India, you find there are many mega gatherings like Kumbh, where crores, millions and millions of people come there, and definitely, even if we have the fecal sludge management, they will not have the capacity to deal with those number of seats. So what do you think that, what is the system and how we can deal with it? Of course, they have the temporary system right now. They dump somewhere. Definitely, they are dumping somewhere.
No. Now we have what is called mobile fecal sludge treatment plants. Mobile fecal sludge treatment plants. In-situ fecal sludge treatment plants. So Kumbh Mela, you have temporary toilets, hundreds of them. People use it. Pilgrimage. Then you have a lot of feces. Now it is sucked out. You can treat it in a truck. So the truck is also a suction truck and a treatment system. It's available. So then operation and maintenance by these systems is equally important. So I'm saying, if you are revisiting your policies and regulations, please include O&M also as a requirement of the municipality. Timely payment as a requirement in the municipality, O&M involvement of women, SHG group should be part of your policy regulations so that municipal authorities will feel comfortable ki acha unko outsource kar sakte. So include as much as possible. Anticipate risks, include it. Then we monitoring system also you include it. Here in Telangana, you probably heard every public convenience is monitored twice a week and reviewed by DMA. Otherwise, all these systems will collapse in 1 month. Monitoring, without monitoring, you cannot make public services work. So please include this in your regulatory environment, regulatory framework. Then monitoring systems, you know, all these are part and parcel of it.
So this
we have an ICT based monitoring system. Those who of you are interested, we will share with you. Yes, please go ahead.
So this monitoring system, do you think that it should be independent from the municipal who is really operating and maintaining, or the private sector who is maintaining?
No, there are two instruments right now we are using. You can see both of them. One is the municipality monitors. The sanitary inspector monitors twice a week. I'll be closing it. So 5 minutes now. Yeah. The other one is citizen monitoring. You can see here, Pattana Pragati citizen monitoring system. It's like a triangulation. It takes time, but building those instruments. I'm not saying everything will work overnight. But building these elements in your regulatory system. Then regulating and licensing, you have covered up to on-site systems now. We need to regulate the desludging operation. So this is very, very important. Regulate your regulatory system should have licensing arrangement, or if you are buying the trucks, please make sure that they have GPS monitored, they have periodicity, then what PPE kits, who will replace PPE kits. We leave it to the market. I say, nahi hoga. Either municipality has to do it or the private operator should do it, and you need to enforce it. So because we have learned these lessons, the future programming should not be spoiled. We need to have clarity. Somewhere that accountability has to be defined very clearly. So monitoring of this is important. Then promoting sanitation enterprise among urban poor through bank linkages with the national program. National missions are available for incentivization in India. And similar, I'm sure every country has it. So these elements have to be built in and make municipalities facilitate, let the municipalities facilitate these bank linkages. They get quite a bit of subsidy for mechanization of this sanitation space. Now comes the other aspect. How frequently this desludging should happen. So we have introduced in the regulatory framework that it should be desludged once in 3 years as per the CPHO norms, 2 to 3 years, they say, but we have used 3 years in this case. And we have also issued a government direction saying that it is mandatory, number one, and scheduled every, like a vaccination as a schedule, dose one, dose two, dose three. Like that, we need to have a schedule. So that schedule has been converted into a GO, and this GO clearly directs how frequently, who should do it, and where it should be disposed. These are all elements of a good leading practice in developing regulatory system. Then comes your, Banerjee Saab, I'm wrapping it up. Then comes your treatment systems and reuse and recycle. Now, what is the purpose of treatment? The purpose of treatment is to not to bring the waste and store it. Then as well do it at the open areas. Why bring all this, like our garbage dumping? Lift the garbage and create a heap. So we are working to create a heap. That is not required. If the purpose is to create a heap, then we don't, then the whole purpose is lost. You don't call it as treatment. It's only transportation. Yeah. Friend, Vivek Pandey sir, boliye.
Sir, very good evening. I just, you told that desludging should be done after every 3 years. But my query is that, I know it would be very costly if you do it every year, but what about those areas which are low lying and floods coming into that areas every year?
Every 6 months you have to do localized.
So localized, is it not feasible if we desludge it before the flood comes in or monsoon comes in?
Yeah. Bilkul karna hai. Because these are localized issues. For example, public conveniences have to be desludged much more frequently, once in 3 months. Public toilets. Similarly, low-lying areas, twin pit toilets, single pit toilets, public, some of our septic tanks have to be desludged every year or even before.
It should be mentioned along with that, after every 3 years, they should be included onto the periodic basis depending upon the local conditions and areas.
Correct. And minimum bol ke likhiya, minimum.
Minimum.
But it should be based on the local context.
Okay.
That wording should be clearly defined.
Thank you, sir.
But it will depend also the design period that we are designing.
We are assuming that the design is as per the design intent. Then this periodicity is recommended. If the design is wrong, the periodicity will also go wrong. Yeah. Prabhakar sir.
Rajari, at many places, especially in Bihar, I can say for other states also, it must be the case. That the septic tanks are actually not septic tanks.
Yeah,
they are more of big leach pits.
Yeah.
Just the walls are lined and the base is cleared. So
correct.
In such a case, how can you ensure, or how a regulation can ensure that one, these are converted into proper toilets, two, these are regularly leaflets.
Sinasap, you know, if I was an answer to this, I would have become, I would have declared myself as God. So I don't have answers for many of these questions. If the septic tank is leaking in, you know, below the ground, it is, it doesn't have a proper base, it's actually contaminating the groundwater. Inspection, some of these things I think will happen gradually. Even in Japan, they took almost 10, 15 years for maturity that they started imposing. So my quick response would be that slowly the startups and technology providers are coming even to inspect that. It's called non-destructive inspection systems. It is common in industry systems, non-destructive testing. Non-destructive testing is also is available. In fact, we are nurturing a couple of startups on this under WASH Innovation Hub for non-destructive testing. So if without doing any destruction, without opening up, you can actually check whether the septic tank is in good shape or bad shape. It's called NDT, non-destructive testing. I mean, it's right now it's expensive, but as we progress, probably we could mature, take it to that level. So there's no answer to this, Sinasab. It will take some time. That's all. So the next one is the treatment. Treatment is for a purpose, please. Treatment is not to dump it and spread it in a what is called a dredging unit or open drain or kahin jagah pe wo jo pits banate hain, deep row entrenchment. There is no entrenchment or deep, kuch bhi nahi ho. I say bolte hain deep row entrenchment. I think it has to have primary criteria of any treatment, especially fecal sludge, should be pathogen reduction, pathogen destruction. That is the main purpose. So this is also required in as part of your regulation. These are all FSTPs. Now comes very important. Ye to black water ka hai. No, grey water ko kya karna chahiye? So you also need regulatory system as part of citywide inclusive sanitation. How do we deal with grey water? Now grey water treatment can be done at two levels. At a point of generation level or it could be at a downstream level. That is, nala pe ja raha hai, nala se fir kahin hai, outfall point hoga, wahan pe ek STV laga sakte hain. But point of generation system, grey water treatment will give you public health as well as environmental benefit. Whereas outfall system, if you put up STP or a grey water treatment system, it will give you environmental benefits, but may not give public health benefit because nala mein wo pura ganda pani ja raha hai. If the solid waste is dumped there, then it will also result in mosquito breeding and so on and so forth. We created what is called on-site grey water treatment system for some of the properties like 100 units, 25 units. If you have an apartment block in Hyderabad, they have to have on-site system. If you have 100 units in Warangal, they should have on-site system. Commercial establishment should have on-site system, on-site grey water systems. So you need to start visualizing from a public health and environment point of view, grey water systems. You are also right now in your policy, please include these STPs and grey water systems should be functional. If it is dysfunctional, then we need to make them functional. It is the responsibility of the ULB performance assessment, annual performance assessment laga dijiye usme. Please include annual performance assessment, whether it is public, private property or government property. Please include it. Nothing wrong. And for performance assessment, the private operators, the private builders have to pay. Why should municipality do it? Let them also pay for it, 10,000 rupees. So this is a decentralized on-site system. When you went to Warangal, I don't know whether... you have not. So when you come here, we will show you some of these systems through on-site decentralized systems. Sometimes decentralization is better. Sometimes centralization is better. Your regulatory construct should also have funds, finances, functionaries, and fear. ये भी बहुत जरूरी है. Functional devolution, एक department होना चाहिए. उसमें dedicated team होना चाहिए. Otherwise, it will become general theory. For example, under Environmental Protection Act and EP Act, Environment Act, many of you are available. Pollution control boards are created under Water Act and Air Act. PCBs were constructed. PCBs were created. If there was no pollution control board, who is going to regulate it? Act will be there at the national level, state level, local level. But who is going to regulate it? So that's how pollution control boards have come into existence. Likewise, this environmental sanitation department should come into existence like what you see वरंगल में हमने शुरू किया है उसमें टीमिंग कॉम्पोजिशन एंड वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बजट लाइन शुड बी देयर इंक्लूड बजट लाइन फंड्स फंक्शनरीज फाइनेंसेस फियर So your policy framework or regulatory construct should have these elements. If you don't have these elements, the municipalities cannot execute, may not monitor, cannot regulate. It will become a nice piece of document. I'll stop here. Now comes a very important piece, the technical environmental standards. So this whole FSM is, what are we doing it? We are doing it to improve public health and environmental standards, environmental quality. Now, we as practitioners of this course should be super clear about what are these environmental standards, what are these public health standards very clearly. Dr. Banerjee, who's a scientist by profession, has worked in laboratory, set up laboratories, FSM laboratories for the first time in the country. He's going to take us through. Over to you, Dr. Banerjee. I took a little more time. But I think it's important to construct this. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, sir. But there are a lot of questions in the chat box, sir. I would like to, if you could take up.
I will deal with those questions. In the meantime, you continue with your presentation.
Yeah, sure. So as Professor Chari spoke on the regulatory framework and the policy framework, let's see what actually exists in our country. What kind of regulations or what kind of standards or acts related to the environment exist in our country. We'll just give a glance. We'll not go through these acts or standards. Later on, we'll go parameter by parameter of what we need, which is very much essential for our fecal sludge and septage management.
I will also, Dr. Banerjee, just 30 yeah. seconds. When you do this, also mm-hmm. ask our friends from Nepal and Bangladesh how they,
sure.
What sort of, you know, betterments they have done, or are there any other things? So just
exactly well. So when I speak the same Indian standards, I will actually like them to chip in and then I'll ask questions. Take a note of it. Go to the next slide, Avinash. Yeah. So as sir was saying, that the governance system is something like that there is a national level where the Central Pollution Control Board sets up the standards. Then the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change looks after that. And then as at the state level, there are the state pollution control boards who take care of at the state level. Next slide. The next slide, yeah. So if I talk of the different environmental acts and if I see in the chronology of events that happened, the first act that came was in the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act, that back in 1974. And thereafter, there has been some amendments. Then in 1981 came the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act. Of course, amendments came. Then came in 1986, when these environmental standards for STP discharge of water, parallelly came this Environmental Protection Act in 1986. And thereafter, amendments have been done. And then later on, when the came up this National Green Tribunal in 2010 to make these acts more stringent according to the need of the time. The next slide. Of course, Nagendraji, I have a pretty long time to speak. I would come to your questions later on about. Then comes I talked of liquids, I talked of air. Now come, these are some of the acts which came in a chronological order with respect to the different parts of solid waste. We are not dealing with them now, right now, at this moment, we'll be not talking in details about them, but just to give you a glance that these are the set of environmental regulations, acts that already exist in the country. A huge number, a handful of such already exist. The next one. Just to give you a glance of what the Water Act says. Now, when Sir Professor Chari was talking of fear. So it's very clear, it very clearly says in section 25 of this Water Act of 1974, it says that without the previous consent of the state board, that is the pollution control board, state pollution control board, an industry or an operation or process or any treatment or disposal system cannot be put out without the consent from the pollution control board. It also says that whoever contravenes the provisions of section 25 shall be punishable with imprisonment for a year with a fine to more than 6 years with fine. So that is where comes the fear of abiding to the act. It's not only the general people who are establishing an industry or a process. The law speaks about the persons who are in administration also. The next slide. Where it is very clearly says offenses by government departments in the same, where it is said that when an offense is, any department of government or the head of the department shall be deemed to be guilty of an offense if it is found to be. But of course, for that, to prove that person to be not guilty, he has to give proof that the offense was committed without his knowledge and that he insisted that he exercised all due diligence to prevent that commission of that offense, which had done wrong to that water. That's the section 48 of the Water Act. So my point of saying is there are stringent rules, there are stringent acts, regulations, there are laws which speak of punishments to create so that we all abide. But then the very general question comes is, what happens if we do not abide to that? I mean, it's nothing to do with the law, just in a general thinking. The next slide. What happens if we do not care for the water? This is something I'm not speaking for the first time. You people have read it n number of times from your schools. Water, untreated water going into the ground and surface water bodies, it pollutes. Water, untreated wastewater mainly from domestic or from food industry, from food industries, they contain a lot of organic components. Organic components, when it comes to the atmosphere, the microbes work on it, they produce volatile compounds, and there is a lot of odor issues. You get smell of rotten eggs, hydrogen sulfide. You get that pungent smell of ammonia. So all these things come up. Now, when these microbes are decomposing these organics, what is happening? They are actually in turn taking the very sparingly soluble oxygen that is there in the water. They are taking it up. So in turn, what is it? What is happening? The flora, the animal flora, the element fauna of the water is getting depleted of the oxygen. They cannot breathe. They die. And what happens is the water bodies always contain these photosynthetic organisms, which are phytoplanktons or the algae. They take up these nutrients, the organics. They get the oxygen. They photosynthesize and they start blooming around and they cut off the complete oxygen supply to the fauna of the water body. So fishes and other animals, they die. Of course, this dirty water going, this becomes a source of pathogens. I'll tell you in my later slides, what are the source of pathogens? Mosquito breeding, land pollution, it destroys the aesthetics. And of course, when such kind of containment systems, we were talking of septic tanks and all these, which contains these untreated water, when people go around to clean them, with unsafe practices, there are cases of death, injury. But then are there laws to protect them? Yeah, the next slide. Yeah, there is. We call it the PEMSRA Act. And that came in 2013, where the prohibition of employment as manual scavengers and the Rehabilitation Act is. So it is mainly to protect the people who are working in keeping the desludging operations and then transporting the sludge to a proper treatment plant, etc. The next slide. I mean, this is something which we have been over and all every time we come across IS-2470. If this does not happen, if a septic tank has not been constructed according to the code of practices, that is IS-2470, what happens? Let's share a story when this efficient journey of ours began. Yeah, next slide, please. A short story. We'll talk of some of the public toilets before our interventions in one of the cities in Telangana. We, from the containment systems or the holding systems of the septic tanks of a city in Telangana, we took samples. Yeah, go there. Go to the next slide. So we took, we divided into three categories where the containment systems or the toilet was constructed, which was less than 2 years old, something which was ranging from 2 to 7 years old, and something which was very old, that is more than 7 years old. And samples were actually collected. Of course, when we work was started, it was very difficult to find a laboratory who could actually do these kind of sample analysis. Mainly, one is the kind of, psychological inhibition where these laboratory personnel never wanted to go up to a septic tank and collect samples. Two, the exact kind of skill sets necessary to do these kind of analysis, we'll come to what analysis was done, was lacking. So what did we see after convincing one of the laboratories? What did we see in our study? Yeah, next slide. If you see the red dotted oval shape, there are certain parameters on the left, like chemical oxygen demand, biological oxygen demand, COD, BOD, total solids. And if you see the content, and if you go to the actual standards in your country, here you are seeing it in units of thousands, where the ideally the unit should be in units or tens. That means there should be only one unit or two units at the max. Here you are seeing the units in thousands, and see the variation. See the variation in the range. Just take the example of biological oxygen demand. That is the third row. You see a range which is saying it from 210 or rather 190 to 5,429. Or if I talk of this standard of total solids, which is giving me a range of 1318 to 6,358. See the wide range. That wide variation in the range. So it becomes very difficult, and it becomes very imperative that we need to treat. And if you see the standards, the first column or the second column actually talks of the standards where you need to bring it down. Biological oxygen demand, as I was saying, it should be brought into two units, that is 30, below 30 rather. In fact, today, if I talk of NGT norms, it is much below 30, should be brought below 10. So that is what we found, that if the septic tanks were not constructed accordingly, according to the code of practice, this is what we see. Ideally, the septic tank, if it is properly constructed and if it is properly functioning, almost 50 to 70% of the BOD load should be going down, what is going inside immediately. It should go down before the water comes out. But often it doesn't happen. The next slide, please. Of course, sir already spoke about this policy on fecal sludge and septage management. What should be the ones? What should we look into? But we'll go into the next. We'll go to the next slide and start talking about what constitutes. I mean, this is a slide I should have actually put it somewhere at the end. But let me put it that way. Like we were talking of fecal sludge treatment plants, and I was talking of the Water Act. So fecal sludge treatment plant is also a plant. So what do we follow here to put up a plant? We look into the site suitability of the plant. We look into the in details, the treatment system, then the design standards, what it will come out with. And finally, what the design intent, the treatment system should be designed with the thing in mind that the final disposal system or the reuse, what we are trying to have it. Based on that, we approach the State Pollution Control Board, and the Pollution Control Board, once satisfied, gives us a consent for establishment. Next step, once the plant has been established, we look for the consent to operate. What do we do there? We do a kind of a project monitoring, and we make them comply to a particular reporting system, and the outputs of that plant should comply to the standards that has been prescribed by the Pollution Control Board. Now, obviously, the question will come, what are these standards? We'll come to the next slide. Yes, please. Avinash, the next slide. So before we go into the standard, especially for fecal sludge, let's understand what is fecal sludge and what are the characteristics, what constitutes fecal sludge. The next slide. Fecal sludge, as you see, is the liquid and solid. You have read this material pumped out of the septic tanks as pool and primary treatment. What constitutes, or what determines? We were talking of a variation in the different parameters or the characteristics or the chemical characteristics. What brings in that variation? If you see the kind of a diagram on the right, it's the tank emptying and technology pattern that is the timings. Performance of a septic tank, how is it performing? Performance depends on the design. Performance depends on what is going inside. Performance depends on the environmental conditions. Performance depends on the water table there. So intrusion of groundwater, ambient temperatures, what exactly is going into the FS? Is it only human waste or something else? And for how long the fecal sludge is being stored? Is it for months or years? Based on that, the whole of the characters keep on varying. And as I said, the grease, grit, hair, other kinds of debris, if they go, they often hamper the performance of fecal sludge at the septic tank, because septic tank is partially a treatment system where an anaerobic digestion occurs of the organics, and such are what you call undigestible things. If it goes into the septic tank, it hampers the microbes there from their performance. And that is when we get these offensive odd odor and appearance, and these things come. Can we go to the next slide? So let's talk of, if I talk of fecal sludge characteristics, we can broadly divide them into three characters. One is a set of physical characters, one is a set of chemical characters, a little bit of chemistry is involved, and one is a set of biological characters, or rather more precisely, we should say microbiological characteristics. So physical characters are very general, like color, odor, what kind of solids, solids in terms of dissolved solids, solids in terms of suspended solids, solids in terms of volatile solids, etc. Chemical characteristics is the pH, that is the hydrogen ion concentration, how acidic it is or how alkaline it is, the chemical oxygen demand. I'll come to what chemical oxygen demand, I mean biological oxygen demand. The nitrogen compounds, phosphates. I'll come to why these are important. Why do we need to check on what is this? Why they should be present or they should not be present? Mr. Chandrasekhar Reddy, could you please keep your mic off?
Please mute yourself, everyone. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. So, and then the microbiological characteristics I was talking of, there are bacteria and microbiology. We have all, the first name I kept viruses deliberately because we are all familiar in the past 2 years, we have become very familiar with the term viruses. Then of course, there are bacteria, there are protozoans, there are worms, etc. The next slide, please. So earlier also, I showed you a slide, a study which we did ourselves. This is actually a kind of a review slide from literature, which shows you those same set of parameters and the different variations that is there in the range which they vary in fecal sludge. Next slide. Now let's talk a little bit about what these physical characters are. pH, as I told you, it's how, I mean, it's, we call it the hydrogen ion concentration. So it's how acidic it is or how alkaline it is. Based on that, the microbes would add, the treatment system would have to be decided. What is the content? I mean, when I talk of very broadly talking of fecal sludge, two parts are there. One is the liquid section, one is the solid section. If you see the cone-shaped picture right at the right hand, there is a part of solid which has settled down, and then there is a part which is water, which is up there. So the total solids constitutes both the solids which are dissolved in the water, that is the different kinds of organic salts or inorganic salts which are dissolved in water, as well as the suspended solids which were suspended and they gradually settle down or they start floating. You see both are there in that particular cone shape. There is a level which has solids have settled down, and there is a black line up above where the solids are actually floating. They have not dissolved, but they are there in the water. So both constitute the suspended solids, as well as something which has settled down, something there are some kind of volatile solids which need to be seen. And all these we measure in that same kind of a cone shaped, what you call a kind of an instrument in the lab. We decide on the sludge volume index. This actually doesn't do a much bit in the later monitoring part of it, but during the designing of a sludge treatment plant, this plays a very crucial role of this sludge volume index. That is how fast these solids are settling down. Now coming to the chemical characters. Hydrogen ion concentration, pH, as I told you, it's done. Now, COD and BOD is a term we often hear. Now, what is COD and what is BOD? Let's start with BOD. I was talking of fecal sludge contains a lot and lot of organic compounds. And I was also talking of these organic compounds, when they enter into the environment, microbes start acting on it. And I also spoke that the oxygen is taken up by the microbes. So it is a kind of an indirect parameter. Biological oxygen demand is a kind of an indirect chemical parameter, which gives you an estimation of the kind of organic load that particular wastewater stream is carrying. It doesn't tell you directly something, some content. It is expressed in milligrams per liter, but it tells you indirectly the amount of organic load it might be having. What is done in it? What we do? We actually take the water, we incubate it at a particular temperature with certain reagents, which does some kind of a process, with some kind of a pre-processing. And we incubate it in India, in tropical countries, we do it for 3 days. Of course, when it was done, I mean, back in England at the River Thames, it was done for 5 days. In tropical countries, we have standardized it for 3 days. So for 3 days, we incubate it. Initially, before incubating it 3 days at 25 degrees, we see the oxygen content in the air. And then after 3 days, we measure what is left in that particular water, how much oxygen is left in that particular water. Based on the difference, we can make out indirectly what is the organic pollutant load that might be in that water. COD, chemical oxygen demand, doesn't include only the organic such load, which is taking up. It also takes up the inorganic material in the water, dissolved in water, which is also depleting it of the oxygen, because any chemical has a tendency, whether it is organic, inorganic, anything will have its tendency to go to its basic chemistry is it will go have a tendency to go its maximum oxidation state. So absorb maximum molecules of oxygen and become stable on Earth. So in turn, it takes up a lot of these oxygen. So BOD is basically a part of COD. COD is something greater. COD is both organic and inorganic. BOD is just the organic fraction of it. Both are indirect parameters to understand a pollutant load in water. Then comes the term is the total geldal nitrogen. K is silent here. Now, geldal nitrogen, I mean, whenever we are, whatever organics we are talking about, contains a lot of these, this nitrogen. Nitrogen in the organic form, organic soluble form. So this TKN is actually, this estimation gives us an idea of the total organic nitrogen content in that particular water we are testing in the laboratory. Ammonia, this is understood. Phosphates. Now, where does this nitrogen and phosphate come from? Mainly, if you look into the proteins we have or we excrete out, the DNA, which has been destroyed in our body, which we excrete out, they all contain not only carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, they also contain nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, etc. So all these come out with our fecal matters, and that resides in it. Yes, Vivek, you raised your hand.
Yes, sir. My just very basic question is that this BOD and COD should always be, I mean, it's dependent on the chemicals used to clean those toilet. Is it like that?
No, not necessarily. You are also you mainly contribute to the BOD and COD when you defecate.
Okay. So those chemicals.
When we say you, it's a feces.
Yeah.
It's feces. Yeah. Sorry.
So those chemicals, do they contribute as well? I mean, yes.
They do, especially if you are talking of those three, I mean, disinfectant chemicals, they do contribute to the COD mainly.
COD.
COD in terms of inorganic content,
yeah,
but not on the organic content.
For example, detergents contribute quite a bit to the COD.
Yes,
absolutely. We use a lot of bathing water in the washrooms, kitchen, flushing of the washing machines. They all go in the form of a gray water many a times, wastewater. That contributes quite a bit. Isn't it, Dr. Banerjee?
Yes, absolutely, sir. So it's COD, and then specifically when we are talking of soaps and these detergents, it's phosphates and orthophosphates. So, of course, as I said, these are measurable parameters, classically measured in the laboratory. There are some classical methods. But then there are these IoT-based, sensor-based methods which are available in the market today, which does it in a more shorter possible time, and then with less of human resource skill sets are required. Next slide, please. Something I love talking about is this biological characteristics, or as I said, microbiological characteristics. Not to create any kind of fear, but these are the different kinds of microbes that are present in fecal sludge and septage or any kind of untreated water. Bacteria in terms of Escherichia coli, which causes colitis, Salmonella typhi, which causes typhoid, Shigella, which causes dysentery, Vibrio cholerae, which causes cholera. Then you have viruses, which is hepatitis, which causes jaundice, different forms of jaundice. Rotavirus causes stomach infection. Adenovirus causes stomach infection as well as some kind of pneumonia. Poliovirus, very few people we are actually aware that the polio, the disease polio of where the crimping of limbs occur, is actually transmitted through water. And then we have these protozoans, Entamoeba histolytica. Many of you have read in your school biology, Entamoeba histolytica, which causes amoebic dysentery. Then we have these helminthus, that is Ascaris, Trichuris, hookworms, tapeworms, Taenia oleum, all these are the different kinds of pathogens which are present in untreated fecal sludge and water. Now, there is a little bit of confusion. This particular Venn diagram is actually talking of, I'm explaining this because specifically when we talk of standards and when we talk of this, what we do in the laboratory, this needs to have a clear idea, like what is E. coli, what is fecal coliform, and what is total coliform. E. coli is a particular group of bacteria which reside in human beings. When it comes to fecal coliforms, is including E. coli, there are other kinds of fecal coliforms. Fecal coliforms could be these, what bacteria I'm talking of in this table, Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio. These are all also fecal coliforms. And then when we talk of total coliforms, it includes these fecal coliforms, that is the human coliforms which are residing in the human colon, as well as the coliforms which reside in the colons of all animals. Coliform comes from the name organisms or microorganisms which reside in the colon or intestines of organisms. So that's how the name comes in. So total coliform is a sum total of all the microbial content. Fecal coliform is just the human and the both pathogenic and non-pathogenic. And E. coli is just a particular bacteria we are talking of. Can we go to the next slide? Yes, Nagendraji, aapne kuch sawal kiya.
Yes. So where does the thermotolerant coliform that we call also TTC? So where does it fall? I mean, is it
thermotolerant coliform is actually a test of E. coli and some related bacteria, related E. coli forms, which are a bit resistant. Normally, when I am talking of any pathogenic microbe, it's in general, pathogenic microbe means it infects me as a human being, and my normal human body temperature is 36.9 degrees centigrade or 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. So this organism is designed or programmed to survive and proliferate only at this temperature or maybe 2 or 3 degrees above. So instead of 37, it may go up to 40 degrees and survive. But something which survives beyond 40 degrees, that is 42 degrees, if you are talking of TTC, thermotolerant, you must be knowing that when we do thermotolerant coliform testing, we do it at 42 degrees and above. Right, Mr. Nagendraji. So we see if there are any coliforms which survives beyond that temperature range also.
Actually, when we do the microbial testing in drinking water, because coliform, total coliform is present in the environment also. So it's a very false indication whether our water is really fecal contaminated or not. So
this is what the slide is saying actually, that these coliforms, when we are doing, it's a kind of an indicator. It doesn't tell you how many bacteria are there. It is an indication whether the bacteria is there. And then when we do it in terms of most probable number, we try to give it a kind of a probable kind of a quantification of it. Yes.
WHO, the water quality guideline of the WHO, it says that we should be all, I mean, if possible, we should be, ideally, it should be the E. coli that we should be testing. Otherwise, the fecal coliform or the thermotolerant. So that's, I was thinking that whether it will fall in which,
thermotolerant coliforms is actually another term when we see it in fecal coliforms. In the laboratory, when we test for fecal coliforms, we actually incubate and see the media if bacteria are growing at 42 degrees and above. So that gives us an indication if there are any kind of thermotolerant coliforms also, along with the fecal coliforms. As I said, any pathogenic form of bacteria would survive not more than 40 degrees. But if you are incubating at 42 to 45 degrees, if something survives, that means that is a thermotolerant coliform. It could be pathogenic, it could be non-pathogenic, but it is a thermotolerant coliform. Am I clear? So, I'm not going into the details of all these, but my point of putting up this slide is that when we are doing the coliform test, in terms of when we say it in terms of MP and most probable number, we just try to understand the content of that particular microbial content in terms of bacterial content of that water in terms of coliforms, total coliforms or fecal coliforms at the max. We do not individually go for each of these bacteria, which would be very tedious and very difficult, and lot of skill is actually required to have before we can come to such kind of an reporting. Of course, when it comes to if what we try to say is, if we find these indicator bacteria, that is total coliforms or fecal coliforms, come up in high numbers, as we say in most probable number, we take it as an alarm that there might be these pathogens which are on the right that might be present in the water. And that is the reason, that is the alarm we create in terms when we say it has got a high MPM. The next slide, please. Now, of course, when you are in a laboratory, these becomes very crucial, whether you are doing any kind of test, there has to be a very stringent quality control and quality assurance protocol within the laboratory. You can always refer to several such laboratory documents. They always in the front pages, right after the preface, these things are done. It's just a very general statement I've put up, but any laboratory should have very stringent SOPs to maintain their quality and give quality assured results. Yes, next slide. Now, actually, this is the exciting part where we talk of these standards. We talk of these parameters. We talked of these chemical parameters. We talked of these physical parameters. We talked of these biological parameters. But then when it comes to maintaining to a standard, that is, if an FSCP has been put up and the two main output components of a FSCP would be treated water and biosolids, what should be the standards? Here, I have taken the recent NGT standards, the standards that have been already mentioned. And then I have taken the CPCP standards. Of course, CPCP standard, I have mentioned only one column because our FSTP is what we are designing. We are using the treated water for kind of horticultural purposes or irrigation purposes. But then if you look into the CPCP discharge standards, there are more stringent standards if you want to discharge it on surface water bodies or in the marine environment. Those standards vary. If there are these columns in this right-hand-most where I'm saying there are no prescribed value, but if you go to a surface water discharge column, you will find there are prescribed values for nitrogen, for ammonia, for phosphates, everything is there. So I took it only the CPCB. I mean, we will share with you the CPCB standards. Right now, Nagendraji, we should be following the CPCB standards, but in times to come, we would have to actually abide to the NGT standards. We have no option. So
in some situations, NGT standards override.
Yes.
So there are situations where NGT is fining the states to the extent of 10,000 crores, 5,000 crores. And they are encouraging them to follow their standards. But technically speaking, NGT direction should be converted into standards by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and CPCB should be notifying them.
So go to the next slide. Now, when I talk of, as I saw, two main outputs of the FSTP, one is the water we spoke of, and then is the biosolids. Now, biosolids, in this slide, if you see, I have spoken only of some physical parameters. I have spoken only of some chemical parameters. So three color categorization in the left column, if you see, some physical characters like color, odor, electrical conductivity, bulk density, pulse, particle size, moisture content. These determine the when you take these biosolids out into the agriculture fields to be used as a manure or kind of a soil conditioner, these determine the assimilability of that particular biosolid with the soil. How easily assimilable will it be? That determines. Then the next set of, which is in a kind of a yellow color, you see, which is total organic carbon, nitrogen, available nitrogen, phosphates, available phosphates, potassium. These are some of the nutrient value that should be there, or that this is the minimum value of nutrient that should be there in the biosolids to be used as a manure or a soil conditioner. And then the next set, which is in gray color, which is a set of, if you see, these are heavy metals, which these are the maximum values, if I say, if you see, it's written max. So the units written there, the content of that particular biosolids, parts per million is milligrams per kg. Again, you can see it. So milligrams per kg, that is the content that should be there. That is the maximum content. While the above one, the central part, the yellow portion, is the minimum content. It can be above that. But when I come to the heavy metals, it should be the maximum that should be there. It should not go beyond that. If it is beyond that, it needs some treatment. It cannot be used as a manure or a soil conditioner, as we say it, for the use of reuse of biosolids. The next slide. I'll come to that question of heavy metal in the treatment of yours. First, let me talk this slide. Now, this comes the very crucial part when we are talking of biosolids from FSTPs. We do not have very standard regulations, but this is actually a kind of, what should I say, amalgamation of different international standards that are there. We have put them, and this is what we try to follow and we should be following. So in terms of E. coli, Salmonella, per gram or per 25 gram, per 25 grams, that is the number, less than 3, less than 100 MPN per gram of dry weight should be there in fecal sludge and for solids. Whether in terms of total coliforms, fecal coliforms, that's less than 100 or less than 1000 that is mentioned. Helminthova, if you see per 4 grams, there should be less than 1 live cell. That is what we, when we see the all these standards comply, we call the biosolids to be class A biosolids according to the Environmental Protection Act, EPA class A biosolids. If they do not comply to any one of these standards, we bring it to class B biosolids. Now, when I say class A biosolids, means I can directly take it to the fields for reuse as a manure or a kind of a how is total coliform? I didn't get that question of yours, sir. Can you speak up? Nagendraji, can you speak both the question of yours? Nagendra Singh ji.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Please.
So in the standard, you are saying the total coliforms should be less than 100 and the fecal coliform should be less than 1000. But
yes,
in the previous graph, you said that fecal coliform, I mean, comes within the total coliform.
This is so, where I, so exactly, that is what I'm trying to, when you are talking of fecal sludge, human fecal sludge, is it not obvious it will have more of fecal coliforms and less of total coliforms? A kind of content?
Yes, but because the total coliform.
So the standards is more stringent for the fecal coliforms, because fecal coliforms is the kind of coliforms, which is the kind of coliforms that is Salmonella, Shigella, are the kind of coliforms which are causing the disease.
No, my concern is that because if total coliform is the state, then the fecal coliform is a subset of the total coliform.
Exactly.
So how the
exactly.
how the number of the
can total I, can coliform, we can we go back to the previous slide? Avinash, previous slide, please. Yeah, you are talking of 100 MPN per gram dry weight, and here you are talking of 1000 MPN per gram dry weight, yes. Right?
Yes.
So
total, because the fecal coliform will come under the total coliform. So if the fecal coliform is 1000, then how the total coliform will automatically will be more than 1000? Because fecal coliform is a subset of the total coliform, right?
Yes. But then when we are talking of US EPA class of biosolids, it's not only, I mean, these are the standards set. Fecal coliforms, you will test only when you are handling fecal sludge biosolids, right? But when you are handling total coliforms, when you are handling other found forms of biosolids, solids, biosolids from STPs, biosolids for chemical effluent treatment plants, pharmaceutical treatment plants, how do you expect to get fecal coliforms there?
No, what I'm saying that if I am testing the same sewage slab, if total coliform is coming
ideally if you are doing fecal sludge, your fecal coliform will never exceed total coliforms. This is just for the set of standards they have given.
That's what I'm saying. So I'm just seeing some contradiction in this standard. That's why I'm just reflecting.
I agree to that. I mean, not completely, but I'll get back to you. I don't think there is a contradiction. I'll get back to you on the explanation. I keep the question with me. I'll get back to that explanation. Can we go that? Now, if these are the standards for water, these are the standards for biosolids. Now, what do we do when we come to the establishment of FSTPs? How do we go? What are the steps we do? I already told you on in terms of the consent for establishment and consent for operations. The next slide, please, Avinash. So these are the different departments which are responsible, the right-hand side, if you see. The authority, the commissioner and director of municipal administration, they at the bidding stage, they have a certain set of responsibilities. When the concession, when it starts, once the bidding is done and the concession agreement has already been signed, comes the picture of designs and drawings and approval of those designs and drawings when the concessioners and the independent engineers work. At the construction stage, there is a regular monitoring of the by the independent engineer. And then finally, at the operation stage, when the plant starts operating, is when we look into a laboratory analysis of the different kinds, different outputs of the liquids and solids. And then only we allow, if they comply to the standards that has been mentioned in the consent for establishment and consent for operations in turn, then we allow it to go for kind of a commercial operations. And then there is a norm according to the concession agreement that every month they have to do an internal testing of all the set of parameters which we have previously discussed. And finally, there has to be a third party analysis at every quarter, and all these reports do come to the authority's office, and then only the release of commercial payments or the operational payments are released for the FSTP's functioning. The next slide. So based on that, these are some of the, I'm not going into the details, but these are some of the FSTPs we have already come up. And if you see, these are the set of, the table actually shows you the set of sampling we have done and how we have tested and what are the standards, IS standards we have followed and what are the results we have received. And based on that, these FSTPs have actually entered into a commercial mode of operation today. Tamam, then next. Siddipet, this is a completely biolith. The previous slide, the previous FSTP was a different kind of technology where electrocoagulation and biological treatment systems were included. This is a completely biologically treatment plant system where both solids and liquids are treated biologically. The next one. This is a mix of biological and some kind of a geotube content where the water and solids are treated. So this is the way we actually gradually proceed into the plant of operationalizing the fecal sludge treatment plants based on the water standards we spoke of, based on the biosolids standards we spoke of. Can we go to the next slide? That's all from my desk to speak today. But as we say, Lord Kelvin says, to measure is to know. And if you cannot measure it, we cannot improve it. And I'm all open for questions, if any. I know there are. So are we going into kind of a discussion right now with the questions? Can I take questions from the chat box? What is the current best practice regarding microplastics and also hormonal levels in the biosolids? Ms. Pinto, I'm sorry to say, very few countries actually now look into microplastics and hormonal levels. I know it's a very big concern, hormonal levels, antibiotic residues, microplastics. These are some of the upcoming pollutants or emerging pollutants in wastewater, and we need to be very alert and get into that. But then there is a lot of research to be done before we can actually talk about standards of these.
Yeah, there are a lot of studies globally on microplastics. And I think Ms. Pinto from ADB can also bail me out. There's loads of literature on marine pollution, microplastics, and hormonal influences, including sexual reproductivity and so on and so forth. So we would be happy to share it with it, but you know, we don't have that expertise right now. So, but all we could do is to point towards some of the global literature research available from, mostly coming from European and American research laboratories. Particularly European standards are going through a lot of revisions on these aspects, including antibiotics in wastewater. antibiotics in race water is a big concern in Europe, and most of the regulations coming from Brussels is now trying to deal with the Ms. Pinto, over to you.
Yeah, no, thank you. No, I was just asking because I have been looking into the reuse of biosolids in agriculture. And this is actually a question that I get a lot from my colleagues. I know there's a lot of research, but yes, I was just wondering if there was, you know, what was the most current knowledge? Because I'm also, there's a lot of research on it, but it's still very researchy. So I was just wondering if you had a bit more.
I would rephrase this question a bit and also direct this question to friends from Nepal and Bangladesh, apart from Indian colleagues, and of course, Africa. Do you have, first of all, standards for biosolids? Are they categorized into different categories, 1, 2, 3, or ABC, class A, class B, class C? Like US EPA follows class A, class B, class C biosolids. Can you put it for agriculture use? Can you put for food grade application use? So I think these are the questions right now. There are no very well clearly defined standards in India right now. Of course, in the provinces that we work, we are pushing it as a local standards. The consent conditions, the pollution norm conditions, we follow that. But as at a national level, how about Nepal and Bangladesh? Do you have such standards on biosolids?
Sudhaji, would you like to speak about? And then I would take your question on monitoring.
Thank you. Thank you. Basically, the issue with our policies and regulation is that with the federal transition, the regulatory entity had not been defined. Though we have this domestic affluent standard under cabinet for the endorsement, and it has all the parameters, but the conflict is which ministry will be responsible for this, whether it is Ministry of Water Supply or whether it's the Ministry of Environment that is falls under the jurisdiction. So now currently it is Ministry of Environment that is taking up this responsibility, but ultimately it will fall into the Ministry of Water Supply because it has to monitor and regulate those affluent as the sewage and the sewer system that falls into the Ministry of Water Supply, Department of Water Supply and Sewerage Management. So this is one of the concern. And the other concern is Nepal had only 11% population connected to sewer, and only out of that 2% goes into the treatment system. But all the on-site sanitation seems to be does not fall under jurisdiction of any government entity. So 89% of the population is still depending on the on-site services, and that is more like at the municipal level, the wash services falls, operational level services falls into the municipal authority, but still the capacity of the municipality, as you said, the information system of the municipality, all these are a little bit still to be strengthened from our side. So it's still in the shaky, preliminary stage. Dr. Bennett, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sudhaji. Now, you had a question over the challenges. As I told you right at the beginning, when I was talking of a story of the city, we studied the septic tanks. Having credible labs who have the skill set to go into the analysis of fecal sludge, whether it's treated water or biosolids. That is one of the biggest challenges. And then, of course, what And there are other challenges. I mean, if I talk of these standards and respect to that, this is one of the biggest challenges we are finding.
No, Dr. Banerjee, let me step in. There are two issues. One is having standards is a starting point. Because if you don't have standards, you don't have reference point for monitoring and improvement. So first and the foremost thing that all of us should strive for, and including India and people like us, is make sure there are standards, whether it is coming from sewer system or whether it's coming from on-site system, doesn't matter. It's all about people and environment. The means of technology is could be anything. So we need to have standards in countries, both Nepal, Bangladesh, India. We don't have standards for solids. Solids means, after treatment, when you do liquid solid separation, liquid goes through liquid treatment and they have to comply with the liquid standards. The solids coming out, either you put it through thermal system like we do in pyrolysis systems, then it's safe. But if it's just drying it, then you're dumping in agriculture or non-agriculture practices, then it has a lot of pathogens. So we need to standard for that. So first and the foremost thing is you need to have standards. Then you need to have capacities to monitor standards, laboratories and so on and so forth. And then you need to have monitoring systems. So Sujati mentioned that, the PCB versus pollution control board versus water resource. Ideally, ma'am, it should be with the PCB, with the environment ministry, because environment ministry is a regulator. The water resource ministry or urban water management ministry is a service delivery agency. So the regulator and the service delivery agency should be independent of it. However, we need to work towards notification, and currently Dr. Banerjee and my colleagues, they're working towards notification of standards. Once you notify, technologies will come out to deal with those, the waste and the pathogens in the waste to deal with the standards. Now, co-composting, somebody asked a question. Yes, co-composting with municipal solid waste composting is an acceptable practice, but it's not good enough in many cases, unless the temperature and you need to properly till it, you need to turn it, maintain the temperature of 60 degrees or whatever, so that the pathogens with, it's about temperature and contact time. Both should be in place. The contact time and the temperature. If the contact time is short, then even if you have good temperature, it will not work, because the pathogens will survive. Yeah, Mr. Singh.
Yes, thank you, Professor. Actually, I was just also wondering that this is the right forum there. We can also discuss if there is no standard, because whenever we go for the training and particularly for the gray water used for the irrigation or agriculture, watering the food plant or something like that. And the second question that we put in the toxic metals, both in the gray water or in the solid compost. So yeah. We don't have any answer on that. So if there is a question in the audience, definitely this ask us, and we don't have any standard, as you mentioned, in India also. So how can we say that this gray water or effluent from the treatment plant can be used for agriculture or something? Because once I was reading, I don't remember the name. I think it's a Central Water Commission who has categorized water group A, B, C, something like that. And they have mentioned something that which type of water can be used for agriculture. But I'm not sure whether the effluent wise, what we have mentioned right now, the standard of the effluent, can be directly used. This standard simply say it can be directly discharged to the water body, not for the agriculture purposes.
So this, what we are discussing is about post treatment. Nothing can go without treatment.
No, I'm talking about after treatment. Talking about the post treatment.
If it is after treatment, Nagendraji, if it's after treatment, it has to, it will have to comply to the standards we are speaking.
What I'm saying, this standard is to discharge in the environment after.
Absolutely.
My question is, can we use this water after treatment, whatever standard that we are meeting, for the agriculture purposes, irrigation purposes?
Okay, I'll come to that. So the treatment costs money. To what level you want to treat is a function of money that you put in. Okay. If you want to have, you can also make sewage as a drinkable standard, but cost money. You need to put membranes and you need, like Singapore does. So what we do is receiving environment is equally important. The standards are a function of the receiving environment. If the water body that you are discharging is used for bathing application like Kumbh or a function or an area where the people take a holy dip, then the standards would be different. The compliance requirement would be different. So the receiving water body, agriculture or receiving water body, is the standards are function of that. But there are common minimum standards. Okay, so we are referring to the common minimum environmental compliance standards. But if the receiving water body is used for bathing application, or if it is used for drinking application, then we need to be super careful about it.
So in that case, our answer to the government when they ask, so what should be our answer to that? Or we can simply say that as of now, we don't have any standard or something?
No, we have standards. We have brilliant standards.
No. I am talking about the effluent after meeting the standard of the CPWD, Central Pollution Control Board, that CPP. So can normally they ask if it is the effluent after treatment is meeting the standard, can be used for the agriculture irrigation or not? So that was the normal question they asked. So
that's what I said, sir. That's what I said in my table. I showed you.
Usable.
If it's complying to the standards, it can be used for irrigation. If it complies to those standards.
Okay.
Here we are talking about effluents, liquid. But unfortunately, we don't have standards for solids that will go on for agriculture. That is where we need to notify those standards. Neither Nepal, Bangladesh or India, they don't have standards for the solid component which will go on to agriculture applications.
My second question was, normally in the sewage treatment plant and other things, we deal with the microbiology to handle this thing. So how we are going to handle the toxic metals that is present in the water, and if there is a limit for that, then what type of treatment normally we practice?
Yeah, please.
When it comes to fecal sludge, first questions, I'll take step by step. When it comes to fecal sludge, ideally pure fecal sludge will not have heavy metals beyond your limits. Right, sir? You don't eat heavy metals. We don't chew heavy metals. So how will be there be heavy metals in our fecal sludge? So
it will be the
that
municipal
is,
waste I'm talking about. Municipal waste. The
so when it comes to municipal waste, of course, you have to see through where the water is coming from. Municipal waste also, if you are talking of grey water and sewerage, if it is not, if there is not a very huge volume of industrial effluent coming in, heavy metals should not be there in high content. It's only when industrial effluents where heavy metals are a very sure shot coming out of the effluent, that is when the concern of heavy metals, both in water as well as solids, come in. And for removal of heavy metals, if you know for sure that there is heavy metals, there are procedures like electrocoagulation, there are procedures like precipitation, there are procedures. So those kind of technical procedures or technology has to be employed as a part of the treatment procedure.
So a good example is heavy metals from municipal solid waste dumping grounds. We call it as leachate. It has high concentration of heavy metals. So that's where it is treated. Similarly, industries produce a lot of heavy metal effluents. So that's where pre-treatment of industry is important. So when they discharge the wastewater, often the heavy metal concentration will be minimal. And because of the principles of dilution, because we use a lot of water for bathing and other application, the concentration of mercury, concentration of other heavy metals come down. They become very, very insignificant. That's the current. But the solution to what you are saying is pre-treatment of those activities which are generating heavy metals to be treated at source before
exactly,
they
sir.
Discharge into the sewer or wastewater conveyance
system. Yeah. Absolutely.
Is that okay, Mr. Singh?
You are muted, sir.
Yeah. Even if you are not
yes,
okay,
I,
still that is the answer.
No. I what I understood, no, it's a very okay. And I was also thinking the same thing, because most of the industry which are not controlled or not monitored, particularly household based also, many activities are happening in some of the towns. So they are also discharging as a waste, as a municipal waste. And at that point, so my question, my reflection is that we should have a very strong monitoring, that prevention is better than cure, because first treat such type of water where the concentration is very high, toxic metal are very high, it is better to treat before mixing to the sewage waste, I mean municipal waste. That I also agree with that.
So there is, I will, you know, this is my last response. There's a question asked by Mr. Hendra Gupta about the importance of monitoring and evaluation in regulatory framework. Often monitoring and evaluation is a neglected area in FSSM, citywide inclusive sanitation regulations. He raised a very, very valid point. I would like everybody, and including ASCI, to be mindful of that recommendation. And without that, the implementation of citywide inclusive sanitation, fecal sludge septage management will become suboptimal in the days to come. So thank you, Mr. Gupta, for raising that. I have come across many many of our regulations. They don't clearly refer monitoring, not just the environmental standards, monitoring of the implementation of the policy and regulation. This is super important. Who's going to do it? Who's going to do a third party audit? In community monitoring could be another instrument. So let us think through this carefully. When it comes to accountability, one of the sessions where we discuss about accountability, we will also bring this issue of community monitoring of some of the policies and regulations. How do we bring that community monitoring systems in place? We will take up that issue. But for now, the point is well taken and it's important. But make sure that is covered in your FSSM policies, regulations, in citywide inclusive sanitation conversations, monitoring and evaluation. Without that, everything will fail sooner or later. So I think we have exceeded the time, Dr. Yes. Banerjee.
Yes,
so I take the pleasure of thanking all of participants for staying such a long period, asking some brilliant questions. And Sinasap asked me a question which I couldn't answer. I'm sorry about it. I'm not capable of answering, but he raised a very valid point. But I think it's a work in progress, and we will take it forward as we start this conversation. We have just begun. We have a lot to go, a lot to learn. So we will see you on Wednesday.
Yes.
On a very, very important topic, which is about gender intentionality in citywide inclusive sanitation.
Thank you so much.
There'll be a lot of questions. There'll be a lot of I'm requesting you to ask questions beforehand. This will be in the form of a panel. It'll be in the form of a Q&A sort of a format. Of course, there'll be some short presentations. So use your, what is that, Slido. Pose your questions. It doesn't matter what is the definition of gender intentionality, what is the difference between gender intentionality, gender mainstreaming, what is gender budgeting, what is its relevance to sanitation. It doesn't matter. Everything sounds a little more abstract for many of us. So feel free, raise your questions so that we become very clear about why we are doing what we are doing in terms of gender intentionality.
My ignorance. Actually, I was trying to use the Slido, but I was not able to find where it is.
So Manjusha Josna, it is your responsibility to make sure to repeatedly inform everybody to how to use Slido, what are the do's and don'ts. If Mr. Singh, even if you find it difficult to use Slido, put it in the chat box. Okay. I'm always there 24/7 in the chat box. Please put it in the chat box, because that session, I want to make it as interactive as possible, as simple as possible.
Use the Slido or the WhatsApp group. We are there.
Okay. So Vivek Pandey has posted that Slido, sir. Thank you, sir. So
thank you.
Feel free, but whichever way is work. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Have a great weekend. Thank you very much for patience. Bye-bye.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.